track for three. Here he comes. He's got a triple. Oh, Jimmy Rollins with that big 20th triple of the year.
Yeah! Long drive. It is out of here. Back to the hole.
Oh, my God.
And welcome back to another episode of Bullpen Blues. As always, I am your host, Kevin Dixon. And, of course, I'm joined by my great co-host, David Esser. David, how are you doing today?
I'm doing all right, Kevin. How about yourself?
Doing pretty well, man. Yeah, it's pretty cold out, but other than that, yeah, things are going okay.
It has been getting a little chilly. You know, we got some off-season topics coming up. We're going to touch on the World Series and how that finished up real quick. We'll get into all that, JT Realmuto, Didi Gregorius. Before we dive into the topics, Kevin, you don't happen to have the time on you by any chance, do you?
I do not.
You don't have a watch or anything?
No, I don't.
That's interesting.
I know, I'm slacking.
That's really, really convenient, too, because if you guys actually head on over to LaTerrain.com, again, that is La-Terrain.com, you can get yourself a super clean, super affordable watch sponsored by the Bullpen Blues podcast. Every watch recalls a story, carries a memory, and captures a moment. If you head on over to checkout, get yourself a watch, and you use the discount code BPB10, again, BPB10 at checkout, that'll get you 10% off your order on a watch. Head on over there. You got the holiday season coming up, all that good stuff. Get yourself a really nice and affordable watch. With that said, Kevin, before we jump into the offseason, we got to talk about Game 6 of the World Series.
We nailed it, David. We nailed it. And if you were listening to the previous episode of Bullpen Blues, what did we say? The next time Kevin Cash pulls his starter prematurely, we hope it blows up in his face. It's as if we predicted the future, man. You know, what the hell was going on there?
Yeah, I mean, it was bad, and Kevin Cash got torn to shreds for it, rightfully so. Dodgers won the World Series. It was bad, and I have a take with analytics, because obviously the analytics conversation got brought up again with that decision, and a lot of people were saying, oh, like, they made the right call, stick with what got you there in the first place. Obviously, a lot of people were under the impression that was the wrong decision, as was I. My take with analytics, and this goes all the way back to when it was first kind of founded by Billy Beane and the Moneyball A's, it works in the regular season, right? When you average out numbers and analytics over a 162-game season, it works, right? Because the law of averages, it's going to eventually lead to success. But when you get to the postseason, right, when it comes to managing ball games, feel, old school tactics, stealing, bunting, how long you let your starter go, who you bring in from the bullpen. You got to throw that stuff out the window. You have to manage with feel. And you saw it. Like, look, it's not like Dave Roberts is a very good manager. He struggled in the postseason, but he went with his gut most times, you know? If Urias was dealing, he left him in. If Kershaw was dealing, he left him in. If someone was struggling, he pulled him out. Whereas Kevin Cash was so reliant on the calculator, was so reliant on the computer to the point that it eventually hurt him, eventually lost him the series.
Yeah, and just to go to your point, when you were saying a lot of people, there were people who were like, stick to what you have done. I mean, how'd that work out for you? You know, I mean, it was so blatantly obvious that everybody except for him could see it. Because look, I know the 5 Rays fans that exist, I'm sure they were not happy about that. It was just absolutely insane, especially with a guy like Mookie Betts coming up. To go to Nick Anderson, who had given up a run in 6 straight appearances, too, like, you can't really defend that. I understand he's your high leverage arm, but, like, dude, like, come on, man. Like, how can you not see that this guy's absolutely, like, just dominant? And I loved after the game how you had some of the Dodgers players being interviewed, and they were like, Once he left the game, I mean, we felt like a new life was put into us. And the saddest thing about it is Kevin Cash stole that moment from Blake Snell. That is the moment he's worked his entire life for. And he just took it away from him. When he was absolutely dealing, there was he didn't do anything to deserve to be pulled out of that game. And if I'm Blake Snell, I don't know how long-term I want to be sticking around in Tampa Bay.
Yeah, and that was where my mind went initially. Like, obviously, I do not play professional baseball. But if I did, and I was a pitcher in Game 6 World Series, do or die, and I'm dealing at that level, I mean, that was the best he's looked in his entire career, in my opinion. He was striking out everybody. Every pitch he was throwing was right where he wanted it to be, and he gets yanked prematurely. And then, of course, the team goes on to lose. If I'm Blake Snell, dude, I'm getting out of there. I don't care about the money. I don't care what they've done to help, you know, revitalize his career. I'm done. That's ridiculous. And, you know, some people brought it and they connected it back to the Phillies, and they're like, oh, but wouldn't you want the Phillies to be in that position in the first place? Absolutely. I want the Phillies to be more analytically sound. It's why I want them to go hire a guy like Eric Neander or literally anyone from the Tampa Bay's organization. I want them to buy into the analytics. But when it comes to, you know, the wild card, right, the NLCS, the World Series, whatever the circumstances, I want Joe Girardi making the calls. That's why you hire a guy like Joe Girardi. I don't want calls coming down from the front office on you should use this reliever, you should pull that starter, you should pinch run this guy. Let Joe Girardi, let the managers manage the game of baseball, let the front office construct the roster in the best way they see fit. And then whatever happens, I can live with that.
So basically you don't want to happen exactly what Howie Roseman's doing right now with the Eagles. Not to get off topic. Not to happen where he's dictating who plays, right?
That is a fantastic analogy. No, that is 100% right. Whatever. Phillies aren't going to be in the World Series anytime soon, in my opinion, so we probably don't even have to worry about that.
Just, like, watching that game, like, rooting for the Dodgers, as we discussed earlier that day, and then, like, you watch the first inning or two, and I remember just thinking, like, oh, man. I was like, it's going to be a long game. This guy's on. You could see it instantly. Like, he just had his best stuff. And it's not even like it was one or two pitches. Like, he was throwing everything he had a feel for it. Like, everything was working. So, like, the hitters were just totally off, just off base and off balance the whole night. And, yeah, I mean, and it was so fitting. You know, Mookie Betts comes up, ropes a double down the line, and right then and there you're like, oh, boy. Like, that's going to backfire.
Yeah, and I mean, the two hits that he gave up were two little bloop singles to the shallow outfield. Like, they were not hard-hit baseballs. I think every old-school manager in the world would have kept him in that scenario. So it was, yeah, I mean, sucks for them. Maybe they learn from it. Maybe they don't. I think it was good for baseball in a sense that it's going to discourage teams from going to that type of, you know, game style managing, whatever you want to call it.
I totally agree. That was one of the things that we had discussed that night, too. I 100% agree with that.
Okay, in other news, World Series is over. The offseason has officially begun. Qualifying offers were extended. JT Realmuto got his. That was kind of expected. Didi Gregorius did not. Now, we kind of knew this was coming. We've talked about it before. I'm pretty much of the mindset that Didi will not be a member of the Philadelphia Phillies next year or anytime further after that. So, Kevin, I have a pretty strong opinion of Didi Gregorius. I want to write an article about it. I haven't gotten it to yet. I want to hear your thoughts. How do you feel about them not giving him a qualifying offer?
Well, I look forward to reading that.
Oh, thanks, man.
But I don't want to steal your flow because this is something you said, so I won't touch on it too much, but just the fact that they failed to extend him a qualifying offer and it was like a little bit less than a $5 million raise than what he made this year, it just oozes how badly it's going to be of an offseason for us, that how tight they're going to be with their money. I mean, they weren't willing to spend that extra $4.9 million or whatever it is. Now they have to fill an entire void at the position when there wasn't even a guarantee that Didi was going to accept that offer, and then you get compensated for it. So, I mean, the percentage of those guys that accept that offer is incredibly low. I know what happened to the Phillies a couple of years ago with Hellickson, but it may be different in 2020, but I don't view that as a bad thing if Didi would have opted in. So I don't really have any confidence in what the Phillies have going on right now, and I don't see why anybody would, basically the point I'm trying to make. I mean, it seemed like a no-brainer to me.
I mean, where my mind went to when I saw that, because I still had some internal hope that they were going to extend the qualifying offer, what was the point of signing Gregorius in the first place?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Seriously, like, what was the point? Because, look, I love one-year deals in baseball. I think they're one of the best things you can do, whether you're tanking, rebuilding, contending, whatever it is. You can't get burned by a one-year deal. But what was the point? He gave you 60 games, and he was incredible. Like, he did exactly what a player in that situation is supposed to do, right? Near career numbers. He ended up batting cleanup for us towards the end of the year. Fans loved him. Teammates loved him. Joe Girardi obviously loved him. It was a perfect one-year deal. All right, if you don't want to hand him a three-year extension, that's fine. All right, I get that. You have Bryson Stott coming up. You're a little bit pressed for money. That's okay. But why not give him the qualifying offer? Worst case scenario, he accepts it, and you pay him less than $5 million more than you were initially set to pay him. You know, his initial one-year deal was $14 million. The qualifying offer is $18.9. You don't think he played up to $4.9 million worthy of a raise? Like, are we out of our minds here? And then the secondary point to that, if he declines it, you get your comp pick. You get a compensatory pick. So they've just completely whiffed on this. And to me, it screams of a team that thought they were legitimate World Series contenders last year. So they were like, ah, screw it. We'll just throw money at Didi and then let him go next year. Like, that's just such a poor way to run a baseball team.
Well, I mean, essentially, they just threw that money down the drain. I mean, that's what it comes down to. Because they didn't get anything out of it. I mean, no offense to Didi, but it's not like they made the playoffs or, you know, made a significant run. I mean, Didi was a nice player, but in the end, they really didn't get anything out of it. So I'm with you. I really don't understand it at all. It kind of emphasizes just the dysfunction in the front office right now. Excuse me, I was looking for the best word to use. But that's how dysfunctional they are right now. It's just so evident.
Yeah, I mean, dysfunction is probably an understatement. I mean, it just,
yeah.
Talk about the lost money. Like, all right, you threw, you know, what ended up being less than 14, whatever it, you know, factored out to over 60 game season. You threw that money down the drain. You also threw the playing time down the drain. You know, if you have to convert Gene Segura back to shortstop this offseason, that's a disaster because you just spent an entire year teaching him third base and second base. If they're planning on calling up, what's up?
Excuse me. So he was pretty good there too.
Yeah, no, he's definitely a better second baseman and third baseman than he is shortstop at this point in his career. But unless they plan on signing some massive shortstop, they're going to move Gene back to short, which again, he was really bad at that position in 2019. So you've lost a year of Gene getting better at shortstop. You've lost a year of potentially developing someone like Scott Kingery at shortstop or one of your young guys or whoever it is. It was just a complete waste. I don't get it. It screams of them being cheap. It screams of them being cowards. Like, they're literally afraid of a good player accepting a contract to sign with them. And that's just completely bizarre to me for a team that hasn't made the playoffs in now a decade that they are scared of Didi Gregorius playing for them next year.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous, man. I mean, at least they have Bryson Stott, but I mean, you're really, with their inability to develop, you're really banking on that kid developing, basically is what I'm trying to say. So they've shown that that's something that they're not strong at. So it's one hell of a gamble, dude. It's really a huge gamble to just think that that's going to work out for you.
Oh, and especially considering the fact that there was no minor leagues this past year. There probably won't be minor leagues this year. Like, how close is Bryson Stott? I like Bryson Stott. I think he's a good player. I think he's going to be a starting shortstop for the Philadelphia Phillies one day. But how close are we to Bryson Stott? We probably could use another 2-3 years of Didi Gregorius, if we're being completely honest.
Yeah. No, I don't disagree with you. I definitely don't disagree with that.
Yeah, and like I mentioned, I think the possibility of Didi coming back on a multi-year deal is slim. The Los Angeles Angels have already been connected to him. They love spending money on overpriced free agents, so it's tough to imagine a world where we get Didi back for less than the qualifying offer.
Isn't it sad that, like, that's basically who the Phillies have become?
Yeah, we're,
like, obviously not on Trout's level, but like, that's essentially who the Phillies are. They're just the Angels of the National League.
And like, honestly, the Angels probably have more star power than we do at this point in, you know, the franchise. Like, obviously we're a little bit better overall team, but like, they landed Anthony Rendon last year. That's pretty big. They have Shohei Ohtani. Like, he's pretty good. Like, obviously their pitching staff is a complete disaster, but like, yeah, I agree. We've just become the East Coast Angels, and we've become the East Coast Angels, but cheaper.
They have former Phillies great Brock Stassi's brother, Max Stassi. I mean, come on. I mean, that team's loaded with talent.
And look, we're both interviewing Dave Dombrowski for the general manager job. Like,
yeah, it's at least because I guess you could say the same about the Phillies, but like at least Los Angeles has tried. I mean, you can't say they haven't tried. They tried Pujols.
Yeah,
they had Hamilton for a little bit. They had Upton. I mean, they've tried. It just hasn't worked. But not that it matters. I mean, screw the Angels. This isn't the Angels show. But, I mean, that's just basically what the Phillies have become, and it's just depressing.
Yeah, it's definitely depressing. And speaking of depressing, I want to segue into the Andy MacPhail press conference that happened a couple of days ago. And we were all kind of internally hoping that he was going to resign during the press conference, and then he didn't. He was all over the place. He talked about how well he drafts and how his team's actually pretty good and how the Phillies are looking for a president, but he also plans to stay on as president, but then he would step down if they hired a good president, but he wouldn't step down if they were trying to hire a bad president. It was all over the place. I'm remaining firm in my stance. I don't think they're going to hire a general manager this year. I just don't think they're going to do it. I think they're going to completely punt this season. I don't think they're going to sign any big free agents. I don't think they're going to hire any really good executives. I think they're going to wait till 2021. Give Theo Epstein a blank check and let him, figure everything out. But MacPhail's press conference kind of solidified that belief for me that this team just isn't going to be very good this year.
Yeah, well, the press conference for me signified exactly what you said. They're not signing anybody. I mean, why even come out and say what they said if you are going to sign somebody, The idiotic comment of why would anybody want to uproot during a pandemic when you have other teams that are signing general managers, that was just like basically how stupid do you think we are, dude? Like really? Like how inept do you think we are as a fan base that we're gonna buy that bullshit? Excuse my language. But like even just the Sixers, they just signed Daryl Morey. Like, what do you mean? Like, you have a team in the same city as you that just hired a general or a president. Like, what are you talking about? So, like, that to me, that's just like he was speaking down to us. You know what I mean? Like we don't know what we're looking at. And it was just absolutely insulting, honestly.
Oh, I mean, you nailed it. I mean, talk about being tone deaf when you have Daryl Morey, moving in across the street, one of the biggest name executives in basketball history that Josh Harris just spent, tens of millions of dollars on to get him to come to Philadelphia. And we're over here, talking about how we might not get a general manager. It was insulting. And it reminded me of the if we don't, we don't comments from, 2 years ago. It reminds me of the second half, fourth best bullpen ERA comments. And then it reminds me of the comments this year talking about how well he drafts. Like, it is insulting because he acts like we don't watch the team every day and, pour countless hours into researching. In our case, writing and reporting about the team. Like, homie, like, we know the Phillies aren't good. Like, you're trying to lie to us like they're a super functional baseball team. They're not good.
Yeah, I mean, his comments were right on brand, like you said. Like, the if we don't, we don't. Like, who says that? Like, I mean, we're a couple years past that now, but, like what? I remember at the time being like, did I hear that right? So, like, I guess I shouldn't be surprised with, I know Klentak's technically not running the show anymore, but this regime, I mean, the regime's still intact, MacPhail's still here. It was very on brand, so I don't know why I was surprised, but it was just like, dude, you haven't won anything since the 90s. I wasn't even alive the last time you won. So, like, that was a long time ago, man. Like, so, like, who the heck are you to be puffing your chest out like you've done this great job? Like, when's the last time you've produced a winner? Not in my lifetime, I'll tell you that. So, it's just... It's really, we're past the point of depression. We're past the point of disappointment. At this point, it's just, I'm pissed off, man. Like, this is just absolutely ridiculous. Like, why am I putting all this time and energy into this? Like, me and you are doing this right now. Like, MacPhail and them, obviously, they don't care. I mean, they obviously think we're idiots, right? Not just me and you, but, like, the fan base as a whole. So, like, why do we show so much love and support for them? I just don't understand, but.
Yeah,
hopefully they get it figured out because It's ridiculous.
And MacPhail thinks we're idiots, and John Middleton thinks we're idiots. And, you know, John Middleton's probably not the brightest man himself, because, like, we just spent the fifth most money in baseball this year, right? And we didn't even make the playoffs. Where you have a team like Tampa Bay, even with all their flaws, like, they still went to the World Series spending a fraction of what the Philadelphia Phillies spent. A fraction. The Marlins made the playoffs. How are you not looking at this team and saying, I need to blow this thing up? We clown on the Sixers a lot in the city of Philadelphia, but they got swept in the first round and they blew up everything. And they're still going to blow up. You know, they're going to trade players away, you know. And yet the Phillies are still sitting here with the same president. You know, you technically fired your GM, but he's still in the building. You know, it's the same team, essentially. And it's the same team that's going to get worse, because now, you know, we'll segue into JT. JT is the Philadelphia Phillies' second best player, in my opinion. Like, pretty profoundly, he's number two right behind Bryce Harper. And he's going to leave. He's likely going to leave. And it's even more frustrating because some rumors came out, not even rumors, more so reports, that Realmuto wants to stay in Philadelphia, that he loved playing in Philly, he loves the city, he doesn't want to move, he specifically doesn't want to move to New York City. And yet we're still going to find a way to mess this up, most likely. You know, I don't know how you felt about the reports, how you interpreted it, but to me it screamed of, this is the easiest signing the Phillies could possibly make. He's the best catcher in baseball. He loves Bryce Harper. The fans love him. He's going to sell jerseys, and he's really, really good. And, of course, he wants to stay in Philadelphia. And yet we're sitting here penny-pinching, borderline gifting him to the New York Mets.
Yeah, I mean, just to touch back on Middleton before I transition, I mean, the guy's worth $3 billion, and he has a bowl cut. So, I mean, that's the level of intelligence. Like, what are you doing, man? You sticking a bowl on your head? You have plenty of money. Like, go get a real haircut, man.
Dude.
But just to shift to JT, yeah, like you said, it screams of, come sign me. Figure it out. I want to be here. Figure it out. That's basically how I read it, is JT. They're communicating through the media. But, like, to me, it was like, look, I want to be in Philadelphia. Figure it the heck out and get me signed so we can just move on. This is just ridiculous that we're having this discussion. That's how it came off to me. I'll tell you what. I don't know how much money he's going to get when you got teams declining a $10 million option on one of the best left-handed bullpen arms in baseball on Brad Hand. To me, that signaled this is going to be a cheap offseason and possibly the worst offseason to hit free agency. So I don't know how much money he's going to get. It might actually work well in the Phillies' favor in that sense. But, yeah, I mean, they got to get this figured out, Dave. They do, because, like, what are we even talking about here? Like, we shouldn't have to be talking about this. This deal should have been done last year. We can say it over and over and over, but it should have been done last year.
Yeah, and I want to touch on the Brad Hand stuff, because I'm obviously right there with you in the sense that that was a big signal of how this offseason is going to go. It's going to be a poor one in terms of money. But, you know, MacPhail made a really interesting comment during his press conference on how the Phillies, you know, the Phillies didn't have a plan in place to re-sign JT when they traded for him. They just traded for him because screw it, right? You know, whatever. And MacPhail was like, yeah, like teams don't sign dudes with, like, contract extensions already in place. And I was like, what? I was like, what are you talking? Of course they do. The Dodgers locked up Mookie Betts insanely fast once they landed him. Like, that's a pretty standard thing in baseball and pro sports and whatever. I don't know if MacPhail misinterpreted it in the sense that, like, he thought they wanted the Marlins to sign him first and then trade him to Philadelphia. Like, none of it made any sense to me. And MacPhail went on a little rant where he's like, we've tried to, like, reach out to JT three times in the past and we can't figure it out. I'm like, you're not negotiating in good faith, right? JT knows what he's worth. The league knows what he's worth. And like I said, he's not getting $200 million. I don't even think he's going to get $150 million at this point. I think we are, you know, we're probably landing more than that $125, $135. And that's completely reasonable. That breaks the catcher annual salary record. It gives JT generational wealth. He breaks the $100 million mark. You get him for 5 years. It's all good. This idea that this is an impossible negotiation when the Dodgers literally locked up Mookie Betts for the next, you know, decade plus. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, to me, it also, like we were just talking about, it speaks to he hasn't had any success in since, I don't know, the Cold War. my jokes just aren't landing today, I'm telling you. But, I mean, he just hasn't had any success in so long. Like, it's just, he's out of touch, man. That's why you don't have a guy who's in his early 70s running your baseball club in 2020. At least that's how I feel, man. I don't know.
No, I mean, I'm 100% with you. I just feel like this team is stuck in the dinosaur age with how to run, you know, a baseball team. And it's why I almost internally am okay with them not, like, spending huge money on a player this year. Because they would go sign Corey Kluber to a 6-year contract if it was up for them. Because they'd be like, oh, yeah, he won Cy Youngs in the past. Like, guys, like, look at the Dodgers. Look how they run things. They reward their superstars. They sign good talent. Look at how the Rays run things. Like, it's not insanely complicated on how to build a successful baseball team. And it starts with JT Realmuto. And, you know, like you mentioned before, revenue's crashing down. I don't think the market's going to be as big for him as we all initially thought. He's not going to, you know, touch Joe Mauer's contract. He might not even touch Buster Posey's contract that, you know, happened with San Francisco. But, like, there's still going to be a market for him. The Cohen deal with New York just got passed. You know, like, he's coming in as the richest baseball owner in sports history. If you don't think he'd love to snatch Realmuto up and have a franchise center as his first big signing, you're delusional, because he's definitely going to be in on that.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, like, the revenue crashing thing, like, cry me a river, man. Like, I got to go to work tonight. Like, I don't want to hear that, like, you guys don't have the money to do this or got the money to do that. Like, speaking as, like, an everyday person, like, shut the hell up, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to hear that. Like, seriously?
No, I mean, it's 100%. It's billionaires crying poor. Like, yeah.
It's absurd.
Look, COVID sucks. Like, we're all on that boat. Like, you know, I've had friends and families their whole lives altered by this stuff, right? Like, it's a global pandemic, right? Like, we're all there. But the idea that it's exclusively affecting baseball owners, right? Specifically when you've got other organizations around the world still spending big money. You know, like we just mentioned, the Sixers just shelled out tens of millions of dollars to overhaul their front office. This idea that the Phillies specifically are the only team that has to cut payroll. Like, y'all are not alone in this.
Yeah, and it's, like we said, man, they're just out of touch. But that's how I interpret it, man. They're just out of touch. They live in their bubble, you know. Woe is me. Like, people don't want to hear that, man.
Yeah.
And I'm someone who wouldn't normally complain about that. But, like, at some point, man, shut up. Like, come on. Like, really. Like, I don't feel bad for you. Like, look, I'm still going to come down to the ballpark and spend money. So I expect you to spend money to make your product better. That's basically how I view it.
No, I'm right there with you. Very rarely do I play the, you know, bash the billionaire owner card, because, like, I get it. It's a business. Like, you know, billionaires are billionaires for a reason. Like, John Middleton owns the Phillies for a reason. Like, I get that. Like, it's still a business. You still got to make profit. I'm with you there. But the constant kind of pandering and complaining and whining over something that's not exclusively affecting the Philadelphia Phillies, when you also had plenty of time to get the Realmuto situation figured out. You had a whole year to get Didi Gregorius locked up to a team-friendly contract. Like, this is, it's borderline self-inflicted wounds at this point. And now they want to pander to us talking about how well they draft and how tough it is this offseason and how finding a GM is going to be so hard, you know, question mark. Like, it's a little out there.
Yeah, it's like, just go get it done, man. I don't want to hear about how hard it is. Just go do it. That's why you are the owner, or that's why you're the team president. Like, it's supposed to be hard. It's professional sports. Like, yeah. Go done. That's why you're in that position. Stop crying about it.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, winning baseball games are tough. All right, yeah, this turned into a whole wonderful John Middleton rant. Kevin, you got anything else in your notes for us?
No, I didn't want to stay on this long. It's been nearly a week now, but, like, just how do you view the Dodgers championship? Because before I let you, like, dive into it, I've just been seeing a lot of people, like, oh, it's not legitimate. Yeah, it's easy to say that when your team doesn't win, isn't it? Like, I still would consider it legitimate. I just wanted to see how your opinion was on this topic.
Yeah, like if the Miami Heat won the NBA championship, that's an asterisk, right? That doesn't count. Jimmy Butler doesn't get a ring. Look, again, same concept from before. Everyone was in the same boat this offseason. The Dodgers came to play. They came in healthy. They came in shape. They acquired great talent in the offseason. They built a great pitching rotation. Like, of course it's legitimate. Like, they came ready to play when everybody else wasn't. You can't use the pandemic as a, oh, this is why teams played bad. When the Dodgers played as well as they did, they took down an incredibly elite pitching staff in Tampa. Tampa's got a million guys who throw 100 miles per hour, and they were hitting the baseball off them. So, yeah, I think it's completely legitimate.
Yeah, and it's not like they were like a splash or a flash in the pan. Like, they've been dominant pretty much our whole life. I mean, for the most part. I mean, I know the Phillies beat them in 08, Phillies beat them in 09. They've had numerous chances throughout the 2010s and then into 2020 to win or to make a serious push. And they've always seemed to be right there. So that's like another thing to me. Like, it's not like they just came out of nowhere. Like, they were expected to be the champions this year. It was supposed to be them and the Yankees. I know the Yankees came up short. But it's not like they were just some like team that just caught fire and it was just like, wow. Kind of like Washington last year, even though that was over a full year. But, like, it wasn't that kind of situation. So, like, it absolutely is legitimate. Like, what are we talking about here? There's no question to me that they were the best team in baseball. So, I mean, right? I mean, they're world champs.
Yeah, and, like, if I told you before the season started that the World Series would be played between Tampa Bay and Los Angeles, you'd be like, yeah, that checks out. That makes sense. So, like,
yeah, I could believe that, yeah.
It wasn't like – it was definitely not an easy path for either team, and it was a tough, you know, well-fought series. It wasn't like the Dodgers just ran over them in four games. Yeah, I think it's super legitimate. It counts in my book. Kevin, real quick, I got one last topic before we wrap it up.
Okay.
Charlie Morton, Phillies legend, had his club option declined. Are you interested?
He should give the Phillies a discount because they saved his career. He comes to Philly, tears his hamstring, and then he goes on and is dominant from there. Yeah. I mean, his post-Phillies ERA, which included this year where it was 4.74, is 3.34 in 546 innings. Before he was a Philly, it was 4.54 in 875 innings. Is that a coincidence? Did the Phillies save his career? I would say maybe. Yeah, maybe the Phillies had something to do with it. But no, of course. I'm all in, man. Absolutely. I mean, he's not going to command multiple years. He's from New Jersey. He is a former Philly, even though he only appeared in four games. I'm in, man. Let's get it done. I'm in on that.
I'm, like, super impressed that you had the pre and post Philadelphia ERA, because like this wasn't planned. I didn't tell you I was gonna ask you this before the show. That's good, man. Good stuff.
Stay ready.
Yeah, I'm with you. Like, I would love to see him back. Why not? Like, he can't be any worse than Jake Arrieta. Give him a 1-2 year deal, whatever. There's no way they do it though. Like, it makes too much sense. Like, they, like I said, I don't think the Phillies are going to be involved on any free agents this offseason outside of, you know, maybe JT if we're lucky, and they're gonna look at Morton and be like, yeah, like he's a good pitcher, but we just can't fit him into the payroll this season. So I don't think it's gonna happen. But I'd love it. Like, yeah, bring Charlie back. Why not?
Yeah, and it was such a slap in the face to see him go on and have so much success after like he was here. Like, they had him, man. And it's such a shame because it's such a freak injury. Like, to tear your hamstring running the first base. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just such a freak injury. And To hammer it home even more, because this blows me away, and I know he was on four great teams since he left Philadelphia, but he's 47-18 since he left. Like, that's crazy, yeah, man. And to put it into perspective, he's 93-89 in his career. So, like, he really, really was bad before he went to the American League. 46-71. And then he turns that into 47-18 with an ERA over a run lower. I mean, my goodness, talk about a turnaround.
Yeah, and it's even more surprising considering the fact that the American League is normally considered harder to pitch in.
Right? That's what it's the Phillies, man. It's those 2016 Phillies, man. They save careers.
That's all we do is just save careers over here. Yeah. Hey, look, we're going to get Didi a big paycheck this offseason. So, a little another player you can toss into that mix.
I think it must have been with Jeremy Hellickson. That's the second time we dropped Hellickson on this episode. It must have been working with him and with the great Pete McCannon. Like it had to have been it, right?
I got no clue. Save his
career, man. My goodness. Throwing the Cameron Rupp?
Dude, I've like mentally blocked out that like 4-year gap between.
Yeah, Borges was in right. I mean, that's an elite team right there.
Dude, they were.
They had Goodell, the Rule 5 guy. I mean, my God. Why wouldn't that help his career playing with those guys?
What a squad. All right, that's a. Kevin, that's all I got today. I don't know about you.
Yeah, man. I'm just glad we got to hop on and do it.
Yeah. No, like I said, we got some free agency news brewing. Hopefully we'll start getting some more rumors, some more leaks. Again, make sure to head on over to LaTerrain.com. Get yourself a watch. BPB10 at checkout. Get yourself 10% off. That'll be down in the description. Make sure to like our Facebook page and follow us on Twitter. Again, both of those links will be down in the description as well. Other than that, that's all we got for you guys today. We are the Bullpen Blues Podcast. We will be back in a couple of days.